Hello, Denver. I'm Michael Gadlin, your host for ArtScene, a brand new show about arts and artists. As a working artist myself right here in Denver, I'm so excited to be bringing you the most interesting, even innovative arts and culture that our city has to offer. Thank you for coming along this journey with me today. Strap on your boots and let's get ready to discover ArtScene. Today on ArtScene, we'll feature iconic Denver artist Tony Ortega, musician Julie Davis, a chance to dance, creativity with Legos, and a new film, A LEGO Brickumentary, and a tribute to my friend Roland Bernier. It's great to have Tony Ortega, a legend in Denver's art scene. Here with me in studio is Tony. Tony, thank you for coming.
It's
really
great to be
appreciate
here.
Having you, you know. And what are you gonna do for us today? We've got kind of students already working and you have a piece in start.
Yeah, well, I'm working in pastel right now,
okay.
Getting ready for a show. So I just started creating a variety of images. I'm doing some genre scenes on black paper, real bold, saturated color, right. Very expressionistic mark making.
Okay, good, good. Now, the black paper is different from the white, for those who don't know, in what way?
Well, pastel is an opaque medium. In other words, you can't see through it.
Okay.
So anytime you put any kind of color pastel on right. top of black paper, it just gives the illusion of coming forward. Oh. Purple doesn't come forward quite as quickly. Yellow really bounces off the black okay. paper. Versus when you work with watercolor, it's transparent. You want the white paper because you want the light to pass through right. and go through and hit the white of the paper. So the lightest colors you're going to do in watercolor will be the white of the paper, where pastel, the lightest color is going to be the lightest color that you apply.
Okay, great. Yeah. Well, show us what you're going to do. Do some more, or talk about what you're going to do.
Oh, sure. Yeah, this is a scene out of Los Angeles that was out there a couple years ago, and these are some musicians walking downtown. And I sketched it in with some colored pencil, and now I just sort of go after it with some pastel. I work very quickly, with a lot of sort of movement to start to create sort of a gestural expressionistic piece.
Wow, that red bounces, like you said. That's amazing.
So quickly I can start establishing a light source if I want on this side.
Right. That's bold. Absolutely bold.
So even when I work in monotypes or work in oils or acrylics, I like having a dark ground or dark undercolor and work on top with opaque color. And all of that sort of is influenced from the pastel work that I've done in the past.
And does some of your paint experience, because I know you as a painter as well, come through to the pastel work? Because there's so much movement. I mean, it feels like you're brushing it on. You've just got a natural handle on it.
Well, it just comes from practice over and over, just making that mark. So part of it is sort of subjective and part of it's very objective. So, you know, it's sort of I go with what feels good, but then I also have to think, well, is that harmonizing? Is it contrasting? Do I need a soft edge? Do I need a hard edge there? But you can see how that black paper works with this material.
Absolutely. Oh, it makes that color just jump, pop. I love it.
It's like letting the material work for you. I like working quickly. If you work quickly, that kind of energy comes through. If you work slowly, then that kind of energy comes through. So I do want a very energetic, very gestural feel to my work.
Very expressive in a sense, right? I mean, I love the strokes that show up as an element in your work.
Yeah, pastel is a very immediate, very forgiving material. Let's see.
Very nice. And what do you mean it's forgiving? How does it benefit the approach when you say that?
Well, if you don't like a certain passage or certain area, it's easy to correct or to edit.
Okay.
That's what I mean by it's very forgiving.
Yeah. So they seem to lay on top of each other very easily, very mm-hmm. well.
There's some simple rules, but you can bring them. But usually pastel wants to work from a hard pastel to a softer pastel, wants to work from dark to light.
Right.
But it's not as hard fast as like a watercolor.
Right. And look how much that's already jumped off the page and what he's got going on. That's wonderful. Man, so quick. You're not kidding about being quick. A lot happens in a short period of time. Good. Well, thanks. We're going to definitely enjoy seeing this in progress. I love it and what you all are doing. Very cool. Very cool. All right. Thank you, Tony. We're going to come right back to see more of what he's doing. ArtScene is about human expression and creativity in all its forms, including Legos. Denver's own Academy Award-winning documentary filmmaker Daniel Junge's latest project is about just that. Let's take a look at a clip from his film, A LEGO Brickumentary.
My definition of adults that play with Legos are just tall kids. I like to build, but I'm not the best builder. Do you want to know who the best builder is? My mom.
I'm finishing up just the last few of the birch trees here behind the library. And it's in the middle of Rivendell, and we're really excited about finishing it, but we're also a little bit surprised at how big it turned out to be. You never quite know when you're working on one section at a time until you put it all together. I just started building again a couple years ago when my son was getting interested in building. Let's make it only two segments long.
Why?
Because we don't want it to be too wide because it's up next to rocks. I went from doing laundry one day to having over 2.5 million hits on my Flickr pages. And it was pretty overwhelming.
For 2 years in a row, Alice's work has received the coveted People's Choice Award from convention goers. This year, she's built an enormous model of Rivendell, the mythic city from The Lord of the Rings.
I think people are going to like it. I don't think that there's anything quite like it. One of my favorite things to do at a convention is to encourage the girls to build. Lego has historically really been focused on boys, and they have admitted that they have only been addressing half the population. They are now taking it seriously because I think there's a tremendous world of possibility that has been untapped so far. There are lots of girls who come up and says, thank you for being a role model.
Fantastic. Now that's what art is all about, human expression, accessible to everyone. So, Tony, thanks so much for that little demo there with
You're
your pastels.
Welcome.
Love it. Love watching your process.
Oh, thank you very much.
I think it's awesome. Yeah. So, I have to say, and in my notes here, you know, I've known your work for a long time and got a chance to see it in all of its glory. I think you're the most iconic artist, and your imagery is the most iconic that we have in the state. For the people who don't know your work who see it now, how did you come about that iconic image, that current style?
I think it was during art school when I took a pastel workshop while I was there, and we were drawing from the model, and it just happened very naturally working with pastel, and I immediately started working on colored paper, tinted paper, and the darker the paper got, the more sort of creamy, saturated color started sort of happening. I began to realize that the mark making was more expressive, more gestural, seemed to sort of accentuate the saturation of the color. So I sort of started when I was in art school, and I sort of built on that throughout the years.
Okay. That sort of came upon like what you do now. I love it that you've... Have you always stayed with the human form as kind of a significant...
Yeah, I think I've always had... did the human form in community and family and groupings, the collective, basically. I sort of think of my work as the collective of workers, students, etc.
And I was going to ask you, too, again, for people who don't know, what does your work mean to you? What does it represent? I mean, you kind of touched on it there, but give me more. I mean, what's... Because your work's about... I love that it's about that.
Right. Well, you know, My family's from New Mexico. I can trace my ancestry for several generations, in fact, before the Southwest was part of the United States. Right. And so I draw upon that history. I grew up part of my life in Pecos, New Mexico. Oh, okay. So it was a very agrarian, agricultural life. Right. I spent, you know, time working with the acequias, the irrigating of the crops, helping with the alfalfa, picking the choke cherries, working with some of the animals, feeding the animals. So I was always around family.
Right.
So that idea of family or community was very important. So, and then coming to Colorado when I would live here, you know, just the whole idea of sort of living in a variety of communities, whether it was a church community, a school community, et cetera, that sort of was a natural step for my work.
Right. Oh, that's wonderful. Now, you spoke of family. Uh-huh. I'm assuming, or maybe not, you tell me, did you always get support? And who, can you tell me some of your inspirations or great mentors that really brought you along?
Mm-hmm. Well, probably my biggest mentor was my grandmother. My grandmother was a seamstress. She made quilts. She did alterations. But she was always sewing when I was a kid, and she's the one who took care of me when I was very little. So what I would do is I would bother her, give me a scrap piece of paper, a piece of material,
right.
Give me a needle and thread, and I started sewing and making things. So I think that's sort of where the geometric sort of influence comes on my work. And then she always had sort of bright colors. She'd get, you know, family's old shirts and blouses and skirts, and then put them together and make these quilts. So that was a big influence. And then my uncle, when he lived with us for a while, he was a carpenter. So I think what intrigued me about his work was sort of his craftsmanship, his ability to cut the cabinets or make the furniture or restore part of the house. I think I fell in love with sort of that sense of craftsmanship, that sense of taking care of things or rebuilding things or remaking things, yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. That's great. So one more thing. You talked about your influences. If there's young artists looking at you and are influenced by your work, and even more, your career, because you've had a rich career for a long time, what kind of advice would you give other young artists? Because I have young artists coming up to me all the time, kind of asking me tidbits. With your rich history, what would you tell them? What would you leave them with?
Well, the first most important thing is you got to make the work. You got to spend lots and lots of hours and weeks of time just making work, you know, just learning your craft, learning your technique. And then you have to live life. You have to experience life. You have to have something to say in your work. And when we bring both the technique, the formal sort of stuff, and then sort of the conceptual stuff, the subject, the ideas, you bring that together, and you have art. You have something to communicate, right? And when you have something to communicate, then all of a sudden you sort of have a body of work that you can start showing.
Right.
And then you can start sharing that, whether you're in a co-op, a commercial gallery, a small museum space, an art space. But at the heart of it is just you have to make work.
You got to make it. That's great advice. For all you young artists who want to do this, you got to remember that. Make the work. Do a body of work. Real quick, what was one of the first significant galleries, commercial galleries, you started showing at that really kind of set your work up for, you know, the sales? And
There was just to be a gallery up in Boulder called the McLaren Markowitz. And I think I was a year out of art school. And I took some small little pastels up there, and I met Kathy McLaren and Joan Markowitz, and they really fell in love with my work. And I think because they were so excited about my work, they introduced it to collectors and to buyers. And you know, that sort of got me more enthusiastic because it's sort of like, oh wow, there's people interested in my work, people like my work, people sort of start supporting that.
That's great. Yeah. Well, I don't know if you remember, I'm a McLaren Markowitz alumni too. Do you remember we showed together?
Yeah.
Yeah, I love that. I miss that gallery. So McLaren Markowitz is no longer in Boulder, but that was one of the first galleries, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they really knew their stuff then.
Actually, back then, it was so long ago, it was called the Albatross Gallery, and then they, about a year or two later, then became McLaren Markowitz.
That I didn't know.
Yeah.
That was so great having you on, Tony. Thanks so much, man. I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Great getting to know the work. Thanks. Every November, Arts and Venues Denver features a great event, Arts Week, which includes a fantastic interactive dance program called Chance to Dance. We're going to watch one of those performances right now. Thank you. That was really fantastic. Love it. In a few minutes, we're lucky enough to have a studio performance from musician Julie Davis. But first, I'd like to take a minute to talk to you about a great friend and mentor to me, Roland Bernier. Roland was an influential artist from our own community who challenged many younger artists around him to push the boundaries of what's expected in art. Roland was a conceptual artist, one who no doubt was a master at his craft. He taught me to have tough skin for the unforgiving art world I was entering. He taught me to make art that matters to me and speaks my truth. He also taught me to challenge all my assumptions. His consistent professionalism and tireless work ethic has had a great effect on my own career. He told me never to rest on what I did yesterday, make art that is relevant, and never worry about trends. They won't last as long as your work will. Roland Bernier was a consistent fixture in the Denver art scene, and his work will forever challenge future generations. Roland Bernier passed away on June 19th, 2015. He was 83 years old. I have the great pleasure of being here in studio with Julie Davis. Julie, thank you for being here.
Thank you so much for having me,
yeah,
Michael.
Absolutely.
This is great.
Good. I'm so excited. So one of my first questions after kind of hearing you, and I saw you at an event a while back, what made you come to this instrument, the bass? I'm curious about that.
Oh, wow. Good question. I had wanted to be a jazz singer 10 years ago while I was teaching 8th grade.
Nice.
Doesn't make much sense, but I decided that I could play upright bass and sing jazz standards, and that would be a good fit. And my bass teacher said, nobody sings and plays upright bass.
And you want to do it anyway. I love it. It's like, okay, but I'm going to do it.
Well, it's very difficult. I'm working on it.
Right. Okay. Well, you're doing very well.
Oh, thank you.
Because it's a great piece, and it feels like a fit.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Awesome. So I also want to know, and I'm sure people who may not know your work and what you've done a lot so far in this short amount of time. How long have you been playing professionally?
I don't know if I am playing professionally.
No. How about playing out there?
Well, let's see. I think I started playing bass about 10, 11 years ago.
Okay.
And I've probably been playing out about maybe 9 years or 8 years. It's hard to remember.
And that's okay. So around that time. So what are the most memorable places you've played that kind of maybe made you want to come back, and have you multiple times gone to some of your favorite places? Favorite places to play?
Let's see, we put on a show last fall at the top of the clock tower, the Daniels Fisher tower at the very top. With Tom from Devotchka, and played behind the clocks, and cool. It was really magical, and it was a rainy night, so there was a really wonderful view of Denver from the top of the tower and the lights, and that was great. I toured for a long time with Nathaniel Ratliff and his folk band, and played in Europe and Canada, and I really enjoyed Montreal.
Oh, so you've been all, this has taken you a lot of different places.
Yeah.
That's exciting. And I'm sure been a great influence. Has there been any, speaking of influences, mentors or inspirations that through your, you know, kind of young career that you've really leaned on, and anyone encouraged you?
Denver's a very encouraging town, generally. I feel like musicians that I know have been really supportive and encouraged each other and collaborated and played on each other's projects. And that's been really wonderful.
Oh, good. Yeah. And quickly, tell me some of the projects you're involved with now. What are you doing?
Right now, I'm involved in this project. Blue Book.
Blue Book?
Yep, this is Blue Book. And
love it.
And raising my son. So that's my biggest project.
Nice, right? Very good.
Yeah, I'm not playing in any other bands right now. My husband has a band called Miss America. But he's been touring a lot with another band, so I've been focusing on this when I get a chance.
Love it. Well, without further ado, I'm going to let you give us a piece. I'm so excited to hear
this. Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
All right, Julie Davis, everybody. Good deal.
Go for it. Thanks.
Would you keep me online up against the mirror's fence and tell me where to climb and collect me every time? Stand aside the marvelous and watch me unwind. Would you keep me online? Mark the places I can stay to ease my mind. I'm saying, my time up against Miller's pen. I find. Don't spoil it, don't run. Enjoy it, hey, it's fun. Don't spoil it, don't run. Enjoy it, it's fun. I find.
Thanks, Julie, for that piece. Love it. That was awesome. Really appreciate it. And Tony, thank you for being in studio with us. It's so nice to have you. Finishing a piece just about. Where are you at with this?
I'm probably 75-80% complete.
Okay. Nice. Very good. So a little bit about the process that's taking you to this point. I see it's got a lot of flavor to it. Tell me.
Well, been real aggressive trying to do it in a short amount of time, trying to realize the image really quickly, trying to be very gestural, very expressive. A lot of mark making to give it a lot of energy.
Right.
A lot of controlled scribbling.
Controlled scribbling. Yeah, what a job to have. You have the best job in the world. Does it get any better than that?
It doesn't
controlled
get any
scribbling? I want to do that. Oh, wait, I do that every
you
once in a while.
Do it?
Can I?
Yeah.
I get to do one. Hold on, folks. Nice.
There you go. Now it's done.
Masterpiece. Thanks, Tony. You're the best. Appreciate it.
You're welcome.
See y'all, folks, until next time when we discover more of Denver's art scene.